tuned for The Joan Quinn Profiles. As an editor for Andy Warhol's Interview, the Los Angeles Herald Examiner, LA Style, and Detour magazines, Joan covered the social set, the Hollywood hotshots, the international art scene, the mysteries of food, the excitement of travel, and the fabulous world of fashion. Joan continues to find creative people on the cutting edge who make things happen. Here's Joan Agajanian Quinn.
Hi, I'm Joan Quinn, and welcome to the Joan Quinn Profiles. Waiting to be profiled in the studio is singer-actor Bobby Poynton and artist Eric Orr. So let's get started with Bobby Poynton, who was born and raised in Chicago. In 1980, he graduated from Illinois Western University with a Bachelor of Fine Arts in Acting and Directing. He's acted on stage, in soaps, and made appearances in lots of TV series. Bobby even won the 1983 Shakespeare Award from the Glendale Center Theater. I say even because for the past 4 years, Bobby Poynton has been performing with the international recording group, The Letterman. Isn't that kind of an old-time group, Bobby?
Yeah, I was, my first day on stage, I was in diapers.
Oh, you were? Yeah. How old is it?
Actually, the group started the year I was born. The group started in 57, and I just turned 36, so... they've done over 60 albums, and I've been fortunate enough to do the last three with them.
How do people come and go, and who's the main force in the group?
Tony Butala is the owner of the name of the group.
I see.
And he still performs with us. Tony and Bob Ingeman and Jim Pike were the original three Lettermen. Bobby left in the middle 60s. And sold his share to Jim and Tony, and then one of Jim's younger brothers joined the group, and then Jim left in the early 70s, and another one of his younger brothers joined the group. So it was two Pike brothers and Tony all through the 70s and I think up to the late 80s. And then there was a changeover of a few people in the late 80s and the early 90s, and then Donovan joined, and Donovan's been there 10 years.
What kind of a sound do you have?
It's still the same Letterman sound. When I joined the group, one of the things that they tried to do was to match my voice with what's historically been known as the Letterman sound. I do most of the high stuff, all the falsetto things, and we try to apply the same principles that the group did in the early 60s, which was to take contemporary pop hits that have already been hits with somebody else and put the Letterman harmonies to them and give a different angle on the same song.
I see. So that takes care of my question about who writes your music.
Right. Yeah. The Letterman never wrote a single song that was a hit for them. To be honest, most of the groups in the early 60s, before that, no people who recorded were separate from people that wrote up until a couple of guys named Lennon and McCartney came around and recorded their own music.
Did it all.
There were always exceptions to the rules, but up until then, most people had writers write songs for them.
Do you wait until the song is a hit and then you decide to play it, or how do
you? No, not necessarily. As a matter of fact, one of the things that we like to do is to take songs like that we think are going to be up and coming. You know, it's kind of like playing the lottery. You know, you think a song is going to be a hit, so we'll have an arrangement done for it, or we'll do the arrangement of it and perform it, and hopefully it crawls up the charts. And we kind of get associated with it as it goes up, as well as the person who has the big hit with it.
I love this because it says this is the biography of the Letterman. It's not the biography of you or Tony or Donovan. It's the biography of the Letterman. 20 million records and 7,000 concert shows ago, three young men in letter sweaters hit the music charts with their first single, "The Way You Look Tonight."
Right.
Do you still sing that on stage?
Oh, yeah. We have a couple of medleys that we do with the hits, The Way You Look Tonight, Hurts So Bad, Shangri-La.
Let's see, there's some
Summer
great...
Place, a lot of songs. Their biggest hit, of course, financially, their biggest hit was Going Out of My Head, Can't Take My Eyes Off of You.
Right, and they said that was two songs in one?
Yeah, it was. Going Out of My Head was one song, and then Can't Take My Eyes Off of You was another song. And the story that I've been told is that when they were doing the arrangements one day, they just happened to be sitting on the piano, one on top of the other, and somebody thought that that they might be good together.
So that's how
and
it started.
They hooked it up together, and they never had a number one song, but that one went into the top 10, and it made the most money of any song Letterman recorded.
Well, obviously, you travel a lot. If it says 7,000 concerts,
yeah. We fly about 500,000 miles a year.
And do you just book into what kind of shows? Theaters or
everything? We do regular hard ticket concerts, and and then like tomorrow we're going to be in Laughlin, Nevada. We're going to be at the Riverside, playing there for 3 days.
Do you play in L.A.?
Yeah, as a matter of fact, we're going to be doing a show this summer out in Woodland Hills. There's a big open concert, big area. Park there by the Marriott.
What's your favorite place in the United States?
My favorite place is Trump Plaza in Atlantic City. I really like playing there. And
does it matter? Is it the acoustics or the stage or what makes it?
It's just the overall thing. For me, one of the things that makes it special, of course, the stage is wonderful and the audiences are great. We always do very well on the East Coast. But one of the nicest things for me is that they have a tremendous Italian restaurant there called Roberto's.
The big draw. What kind of, talking about the big draw, I was just thinking while you were talking, what kind of people come to watch your show? Do you get young
people?
It
really depends, yeah. At our regular concerts that are promoted for us, I would say most of the age group is 45 to 60. But then we do a lot of state fairs and things like that. My very first show that I ever did with the Letterman 4 years ago was in Kansas City, and it was an outdoor concert in a park there, and there were 30,000 people there. And I walked out on that stage, and I just saw a sea of humanity, and I was floored that the Letterman could still draw that kind of people.
I know, it's amazing. What kind of music do you call it?
Adult contemporary,
romantic.
Know, standards. We do everything because one of our newest hits, and I shouldn't say hits, one of our newest recordings is Everything I Do For You from Robin Hood. So we do that, and then we go all the way back to The Way You Look Tonight and Love Is a Many Splendored Thing we do every night on stage.
Oh, I bet, because that was the great harmonic thing.
Oh, yeah, that's...
We have a clip of that Robin Hood movie theme, so let's see it. That is a great sound, but it doesn't look like you're paying attention to each other.
Well, we try to pay as much attention as we can, but when we're on TV, it's a little bit. Sometimes we're out of our element because our stage show is really what the Letterman have become about over the years.
So that was a TV performance.
Right, it was from a show called Nashville Now that's recorded at the Grand Ole Opry.
I see. When you're on stage. Is there anything more to the show than just singing?
Yeah. The show is really what's kept the Letterman going for all these years, I think, because it's a lot of audience involvement, a lot of the Letterman hits, a lot of mix of contemporary and standards and classic songs, and we do a symphony show. We do a show with symphonies across the country, and lots of different things.
Do you play instruments?
No, Donovan plays guitar, but Tony and I don't play anything.
Not during.
No.
Well, how did a person who wanted to be an actor and a director wind up with the Letterman?
I was actually looking for any kind of a gig at the time. I had been unemployed for a little while, and I answered an ad in Dramalog. There was an ad that Tony had taken out when one of the guys was leaving, sent in my demo, and I got the job.
But how, were you a singer, obviously?
I hadn't sung in 10 years up until the time I got the job with the Letterman.
Were you trained as a singer?
I've never had training, no. I just kind of
You just
sang.
Guess, that's a real actor, going out and guessing it no matter what happens,
huh? I can be taller, I can be shorter, I can sing, you know, whatever.
That's great. And we want to thank you for being with us today, Bobby Poynton, and bringing us the Letterman, which I'm sure will live on and on and on.
I hope so.
Do you think you'll get back into acting?
I hope to. I really do. I'm trying to right now. My wife's the actor in the family right now, so I'm hoping to get back into that.
Okay, I want to see the two of you together.
Okay.
Acting together.
Sure. We haven't done that since Days of Our Lives. Yeah.
Amy Stockpointon.
Right.
Good. And thanks again.
Thank you very much.
Don't go away. We'll be back with artist Eric Orr. Hi, I'm Joan Quinn, and we're back with Eric Orr, an artist with an international reputation, a sculptor known for his outdoor commissions, pieces that are exciting as well as monumental. Right, Eric?
Well, they're monumental, and I think the excitement comes from the use of primary materials. I think we got a clip that's going to show us some of that.
Right. Let's go right to the clip, and you can tell us what we're looking at.
You're looking right now. And that's the pattern that the water flows as it goes down the surface of the sculpture. This is a small sculpture in front of the San Juan Bank building. There are two columns. One is, they're both bronze. Water goes down and then fire goes up the surface of the water.
Small, how big is that?
It's 40 feet.
Small sculpture.
When the fire is on, you have this wonderful a moment where you're watching traffic and there's a red light that turns to green and everyone stays still. This is a building I was asked to light in downtown Long Beach. So I lit the outside edges, and then on the top of the building I put four xenon lights that makes a pyramid that goes up about a mile and a half.
Is this on every night?
Every night. And of course, because there's so much atmospheric differences, the whole thing changes at night.
The color changes as well?
No, it's a white blue. Xenon, it has the broadest spectrum of light of any light source. This is a small commission at a private residency.
Is
water and fire. Fire rolls out the water. Go ahead.
Is the fire on all the time too?
The fire's on as much as the person wants to turn it on.
I see.
The one downtown is on every 15 minutes for a minute. This is the Marriott Hotel in San Francisco. It's right in the lobby. People usually check in if they haven't seen it and rush immediately to the work, so I feel real good about it. It has a lot of interaction, and it has this kind of east-west sensibility to it. That's a wide sculpture. We're just going through a series of different kinds of forms right now in the sculpture. They all have water. This reminds me of the one downtown in that it's two columns. This is out in the desert area. That's a model of the one in downtown Los Angeles at Wilshire and Figueroa.
Is that in your studio, that model?
No, the model belongs to Mitsui.
I see.
And this is a fire and water work in a garden setting. This is another, it's a black granite sculpture. I use granites and all kinds of stones and all kinds of metals. That's at the Grinsteins, it holds up the roof. This is a wedge shape work outside. You can see the pattern, how it goes down. The pattern comes from the way the surface is ridged. This is a very simple direct work. It's black granite. The next one coming up is Honey Onyx, which is luminous in that it transduces light, so the work glows as light hits it. And this is a work at Maple Drive Restaurant.
Is this water running all the time?
The water recycles over and over. And it I hardly use any water to achieve what I want to see. And that's it.
How you talk about using different surfaces, granite,
right.
Metal,
right.
I don't know, and they're all ridged
that's right.
These tall water pieces.
I'll tell you how it starts fairly simply. I did a work at L.A. County Museum, which was 23 feet. We ran a 3-inch gas line up a pipe, slit the pipe, and then when the fire went on, the whole area was surrounded by a cloud. So it was a 23-foot fire in the center of a cloud. So some people in Pasadena invited me to do a work with them. The cloud would work great, except they wouldn't be able to see anything in their house. It would just completely inundate their house, so I dumped the cloud.
Was it mist?
Yes, it's high-pressure water, below 10 microns, like cigarette smoke, so the mist goes up like cloud. So I came up with this ridge system in order to have the work accessible to the humans that were there. Otherwise, the cloud just completely inundates the house.
But the whole thing started with water and fire then.
Right, exactly.
And then it went on to these towers.
Right, exactly.
But they're not all towers. I saw one of your pieces was wider.
That's right.
And then, so the ridges, are the ridges different sizes?
The ridges are different sizes, but they all had the same angle, and the angle allows me to have that pattern. Took me about 2 weeks to find the right angle and pattern, but I did.
And then do you ridge it, or you give the specifics on how to ridge it?
I work with stone people and metal fabricators. Usually I generate the idea, look at the site, and then do the follow-through in terms of setting it up.
You've done hundreds of public commissions.
I've done a number of public commissions.
Well, I know you've done,
It's a test of humor, that's all. It tests your ability to handle all kinds of situations.
But how do these commissions come about?
They come from all different sources. They come from the public wheel, which means that a city will invite me, or a corporation will invite me, or a private person will invite me. So it comes from all different areas.
If it's for a public park,
yeah.
Or it's a public commission. Do you have to do any kind of indoctrination for the people who live in the park, or the people who work around the park, or do they just accept it because it's put there?
One of the interesting aspects of my work is when you see the work, people usually are drawn towards it, and it has the ability. Where it doesn't rely on a cultural education, you're just drawn towards it because you're drawn towards fire, you're drawn towards water. These are kind of essential things. And the pattern that I came up with has a certain mesmerizing aspect, so people just will stare at the work. So the guy that delivers Federal Express or the president of a corporation equally respond to the work. It's kind of...
So you really don't have to do much indoctrination.
No.
It's something that sells itself, so to speak.
Exactly. Because I think because I've hit upon certain things that touch the spirit of man. I mean, the fire certainly touches us, that's for sure.
When we looked at this, you mentioned that there was a piece in Maple Drive. I know you had a piece in the restaurant Trump's.
Right.
You also had pieces in a lot of restaurants. Do you think there's a particular reason for that? Or do you just like to eat?
I like to eat great food. One of the aspects about my work that seems to work out very well with restaurants is that you can sit around and it relaxes you and puts you in a good kind of state of mind. It's curious because unlike a museum, where you go and you look at works very quickly, and then at the end of your museum experience, you say, well, what did you see? And you say, oh, I... if it's in a restaurant, it's going a longer period of time, like a house, you see, like a home. so you can appreciate the work in a longer period. I like museums more, howsomever, it's interesting how it affects humans.
It's interesting, too, also when you're saying that, because if it's in a public place, people usually are going back, repeating their passages by these public places, so they probably get to see it more and become acquainted with the work. If it's in, say, the middle of a island in a street or by something outside.
Right now, I've been doing maybe two or three works a year in Japan in major cities, and that has given me quite a view of how the work can be received in other cultures. Like you speak of restaurants, I just did one in Hong Kong in a restaurant.
Uh-huh.
So if you're ever in Hong Kong.
Do they ask for the same thing? I mean, is this kind of like what Eric Orr is known for?
Luckily, I have been doing different kinds of things all my life. I started with light and space, which is a particular California phenomena. And then I went into sculpture, and then I went into painting, and now I do a little of all three of these, including light stuff. So I'm known a lot for the water sculptures because generally I'm just a prolific kind of human being. Like, I make a lot of mm-hmm. artwork. But I love the paintings, and I love the spatial stuff as much.
But light and space is the type of thing that has to be an installation, right? Or it's ephemeral. Does it last? If you were going to do a light and space, or you did a light and space installation, say, at the Los Angeles County Museum, and it belongs to their collection, do they leave it up all the time, or you want to take it and show it in Chicago?
Okay, well, the Silence in the Ion Wind, the work I did, I had a floor of the County Museum in order to do this particular artwork.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, they're not going to leave it up. Howsomever, I have a work that's 50 foot long by 20 by 10 in a museum in The Hague, which is just dedicated to light. It's an empty white space.
And it's there all the time.
Right.
Now, what if you were to depict that piece, because they say we want to show Eric's a retrospective of Eric's work. Is that still an original? That, like the piece in The Hague, would that be, you couldn't take that out of there because the space is built for that.
Thank God for versatility in art, though.
How do you do it? What is it?
Well, the way you'd go about that is, like, I would do a work that has the essence or the rudiments of the work that we were talking about in The Hague. I think that when you do like a show, it's important to make sure that it has a lot of interest, that humans can, when they come in, are pulled towards. So the work would be sided to the show.
So is it then what you do for the next show original? Or most of the time when you take a painting, this is the original painting. How does it work in light and space? How does it work with these fountains? Can you move a stock? What do you call those? A tier of water? Column of water?
Everything that's made that I make can be moved. Some of it is more rigid, but ultimately it's just bolted to the ground. All right. The light and space work is... Let's say Giuseppe Ponzone's maybe 11 of my light and space works. And they can be set up anywhere.
It just needs
a certain amount of space that's required to set up. And if necessary, you just modify the work to fit the space.
So does it have like...
So it would be a new work. It would be an original work to
answer
your question.
Each time it goes out, it's an original work. Do you have...
I guess all experiences are original.
That's what I would think, yeah. So do they have architectural drawings?
Yes.
So then those could be modified.
Yes.
What if someone modifies it without you? Do you have to make the modifications for it to still be an Eric Orr?
It sure helps. You know how you know what happens when people get real creative and you can't even recognize what you've done.
I have, going to your paintings, I have this.
It's a blue void. When I started making paintings, I came at it late, and I came at it from the position of light. So a lot of my works are monochromatic, and it looks like light is emanating or coming out of the painting.
Uh-huh. I said, do we have another one here?
I don't know. Oh, there's
here.
A red one.
There's a red one.
So you can see it's kind of swirling around the outside. That's 29 by 24, so it's fairly small. Again, I just this has a little sense of fire to it. It also, of course, a real fire painting would be much better than just like a paint painting. So presently I am working on real fire paintings right now, and I'm playing around with how I adjust fire itself. So I've been playing with fire lately.
I know you spend a lot of time in Europe, because when I was in Barcelona, yeah. I ran into you and you were working right. there. What kind of work were you doing there?
That was a series of prints. It was done by a company in Barcelona. They invited a number of California artists over, and we did prints and etchings, and it was a fabulous time, although the eating got me. Because you start at 10 o'clock at night. You know? It's so, like early dinner.
I think to explain your work, you're a sculptor, a painter, a printmaker.
Yeah.
Did I miss anything?
A light and space.
A light and space.
And I've done some stuff with architecture, where I'm working with an architect where we designed the whole space. And that's been.
Where were you born?
Kentucky.
But would you consider yourself a native Californian now?
I think after 10 years, you're automatically a native.
Is that all the time you've been here?
I've been here for an eon, at least 25 years.
And so I always considered you a California artist, and you started that light and space thing
right.
at the same time, and installations.
Right, and there was... it's interesting because like Jim Terrell and Bob Irwin and Larry Bell and Maria Norman and a number of other people started working on this, many of whom did not know each other at the beginning.
So this brought
them
all?
They were actually working on individually, and then they came together. Mm.
So this brought everyone together. Yeah. Well, I'm glad that you were on, and I'm glad you explained a little bit of the background of California light and space and air and water and fire and everything else. Thanks a lot, Eric
Orr.
My
great pleasure.
Thank you. And thanks for being with us today, and we'll see you next time on the Joan Quinn Profiles.